it's time for those most famous words in motorsports. Travis, start your engines!
Take your hobby to the next level with a quality racing rig that works great with a PS3, Xbox 360, and a PC. GT Omega Racing Simulator is compatible with a wide range of steering wheels, including Logitech, Fanatec, Thrustmaster, and more. The GT Omega is available now worldwide by going to www.gtomegaracing.com.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to IRL TV's broadcast of the iRacing Grand Prix Series. This is week one, Strength of Field Race, and we are at Sonoma Raceway in California. With me this week, I've got Dean Prescott. My name is Lee Thompson, by the way. I suppose it might help if I say that as well. Hi, Dean.
Hi, Lee. How's things?
Not too bad. Just trying to get into the session still. I presume you're not in yet.
No, I'm just three more minutes, I can see.
Well, we're expecting an action-packed race for this first week. So, week one, we've got potentially a lot of DWC drivers that are going to be joining us in the session. We're just waiting to see who we're going to end up with today.
How will that affect the standings at the end of the daily?
Well, unfortunately, kind of the purpose of this race, in a sense, and certainly these strict field races, is to get the top 10 ready for the iRacing Pro Road Series. For the end of the series, so the top 10 points finishers at the end of our 12 weeks minus 4 drop weeks will get promoted to the Pro Series. But really, with these DWC drivers mixing up, actually, we may even find that these strength field races don't really show us the real top 10 until maybe later in the season.
And any new changes to the car?
Well, we've had our new build, you know, just a week or so ago. And I think everyone's probably struggling to a little bit to still find, you know, exactly their feet on any differences in setup and really getting themselves comfortable making sure they know what we're going to be doing. Main differences, well, this race is going to be fairly unusual, I think, for iRacing Grand Prix Series in that we are looking potentially at a no-stop race. So certainly for the last couple of seasons, we've been looking consistently at one-stoppers. Might possibly have someone looking at a single stop. But really, I think we're looking at no-stop races for this race anyway.
Is this the first time that the car has been here, or...?
Season 2, 2012, that was the last time we were here, so we have not been here for a couple of seasons now. Pole was by Andrew Slocum, and it looks like he won both the Strength of Field races that week as well. Pole back in Season 2 was a 107 flat, so even with the changes that we've had over the last couple of seasons, especially this new build with a new tyre model, new steering model. Actually, we're looking like we're within a couple of tenths of that pace anyway. Pole, unless anyone squeezed in at the last minute, was a 107.229, which is Luke McLean. So yeah, we're really looking pretty close to the pace from old season two.
Please forgive me. I do not race this car at all, but I know Lee does. So all the technical questions will be going his way.
Yeah, and then I'll be throwing extra technical questions to spectator chat where no doubt there's some DWC drivers hiding in there to help me out.
I'm pretty sure there will be.
But yeah, in terms of the car at this track, I mean, this is a tough track really to start off with, and maybe that's shown a little bit with the attendance of this week. I mean, as far as I know, last time we've only had two official races for the whole week, which were both last night, I think. And so this is probably going to be the next one from there. So hopefully attendance will improve as perhaps we get to some more forgiving tracks or more enjoyable tracks. I mean, Sonoma Raceway, it's obviously not held F1 in real life. Most commonly, or the big draw is NASCAR, it seems, here, the NASCAR road course. It's a tight, twisty circuit, lots of crests, lots of undulations. It's a tough, tough track for this, you know, very, very powerful and high-performance F1 car.
I do believe the NASCAR guys run the slightly shorter course. I'm not sure if the IndyCar come here once every blue moon.
I don't think they've been here for a while, but yeah, I think they certainly have been before. I think that's presumably going to be the closest related racing that they've had at this circuit.
Come on, Harrison, let's have this session. Frantically, yeah, refreshing the pace to join.
Yeah, this feels
good. And there it is. So yes, session's now staging, as it were. Fingers crossed we get in there as soon as possible.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see who we have attending this race, because I said there's a fair mix of drivers in the qualifying who's actually put in a time. So who's actually going to bother, in inverted commas, of the DWC drivers enter this race, we'll find out any moment.
When was the name of the track changed as well? So I'm sure last season it was Infineon, maybe?
Yeah, Infineon Raceway. And I believe that was just a pure sponsor name. So like maybe we're more familiar with over here with football stadium names and that side of things, Emirates Stadium and similar. So as far as I know, it's just that sponsorship contract ended and they've gone back to Sonoma, which is actually the location where the circuit is.
Quite interesting.
Well, we try. I think it used to be called Sears Point as well, which is the range of mountains perhaps in the area.
Ah. Right, I'm now in the session.
Cool, I'm almost there as well. How are we looking? Many people in warm-up already?
There's 18 on the grid for this first Stratford Field race. It looks like we have 17 joined to the session. Just waiting on Liam Williams, actually.
Yeah, and I think we've got three splits for this strength of field race. So we have got a good attendance then, actually, for this first week. Not too bad at all. And a quick look at the names that we've got in a minute. So going through ranking order. In fact, let's go through the grid. So, yeah, the grid. Well, DWC driver certainly are here. So we've got Luke McLean, DWC driver. He's got the overall pole position time for the week. So he was our 107.229. He's here. We have Max Delorco, I believe he's an A-class driver at the moment, in second position. Stephen Michaels, another DWC driver. Jorn Jens, Troy Schultz, Alex Simpson, Javier Soto, Oli Fakala, Samuli Kumo, and Matteo Calestanani. Oh, I'm going to struggle with a couple of names, I do apologise. So that's our top 10 that we've got here. So we have got a few DWC drivers mixing in, but maybe not as many as have put qualifying times in. So actually that's good for us in a sense that we can actually look at who's going to be fighting for this top 10 pro road positions.
Yeah, we've just seen on screen that there's a little incident coming into the final airpin. Hopefully that's not going to cause too much of an issue.
Yeah, get it out of the system in warm-up at least.
Fingers crossed this will be a good race.
Yeah, we're nearly there. We've got 45 seconds or so until everyone should be gridding up. And then week one, we'll be getting started.
So who are your odds-on favourite for then?
Well, I think it's, you're going to have to look at the two DWC drivers that we've got in here straight away. So, yeah, Luke McLean and Stephen Michaels, they're the two names that really leap out at me. Obviously, Luke, I mean, he's 3 tenths up on that that qualifying time to the next position, Max in second there. So, really, I think, yeah, that's got to be our starting point. Obviously, from a personal point of view, we're leaning towards our Arik drivers a little bit, aren't we, Dean? So, representing Arik today in the top split, looks like we've got, yeah, Alex Simpson, Samuli Kumo, and Liam Williams. They are our 3 Arik drivers, so we'll be keeping an eye on them, but trying not to to focus too much from a selfish point of view, hopefully.
Yeah, let's try and not be biased with this one. But come on, guys.
Right, so it looks like warm-up's coming to an end, so everyone's going to start gridding up momentarily.
Turn one. Is this a easy corner or?
Well, technically, I think we're looking at turn two. So yeah, turn one coming off the line is should be a bit of a non-event. Turn two, yeah, it's tough. As I mentioned earlier, we've got these crests, these undulations, and that's really going to be the first one. So turn two is very, very tight, going up the hill, and then coming off the exit, you go over the crest, the rear gets get very light. I think everybody's going to need to be very, very careful into turn two. And I mean, the standard of drivers we've got here, well, hopefully they will. It's a relatively long race, 35 laps. We were looking at 1 minute 10 laps race time sort of and quicker. So we're looking at a long race. So hopefully, people aren't going to get too carried away too quickly.
Revs are building.
So, ARL TV's broadcast is away. We're at Summer Raceway Week 1. iRacing Grand Prix. Oh, carnage.
So, Tony Schultz, where was it?
Yeah, I think so. So we've got, unfortunately, the second half of the field strung out already. The leaders look like they're cleanly through for now.
If you want to just follow that on, I'll have a quick look.
Yeah, so we have Luke McLean still. Did he hold on to that first position? He's making a run for it already. He's got a little bit of a gap to the next cars behind. Then behind we've got Max still in P2, Steven P3, Javier Soto in P4, Samuel Pope. Five. We've got the replay coming up showing the start now, and yeah, it's just, I think unfortunately one car got loose and frightened all the other cars behind, maybe into taking action,
was,
and that was the
Troy Short,
chain
unfortunately.
Reaction. Troy was it, yeah.
Catching, unfortunately, Alex Simpson.
Oh, Alex. I cursed him by wishing Eric luck at the start perhaps, well. But the front half is still running away, look like quite clean, so we've still got the leaders here. Running tailed, nose to tail as they're heading through.
Luckily, Sam Kumo desperately trying to break and get out of the way at the start and gets away cleanly.
I think, we'll see how the race settles in. I think we're not going to see a huge amount of overtaking here today. I said this is a tight track that the guys are racing on. We've got these crests, these undulations as well. It's really going to be a lot of single file racing. We've got 2 main opportunities for overtaking. First one is going to be into the first hairpin that the leader is heading into now. But that's really going to take a mistake from someone off a carousel to be able to look to overtake into turn 7 there into the hairpin. The second one, well, that's going to be turn 11 really, coming off the S's. And again, though, it's going to take a mistake from somebody in front to really have an opportunity to overtake.
We have Max here under a lot of pressure.
Yeah, so we've got a possibility. So with a new build, how people are going to be dealing with the dirty air, how their setups are going to be coping with that, we're yet to see. But yeah, very, very close going through the hairpin there.
Yeah, it's a very, very strange line there as well.
I think there are differences. All these look like we're going in a real battle for position two. They're going into turn two. I thought he was going to take a look into the inside of turn one, outside of turn two, but quite wisely, thought better of it.
Nothing else seems to be happening further down the field. As my piece of software crashes on me.
Excellent timing. Well, so Luke McLean, as I thought, with his qualifying lap, 3 tenths up on anyone else, he's pulling away already. We're looking at a good couple of second gap that he's got now to Max there in seconds.
Yeah, roughly about 1.6 seconds.
So yeah, working our way down. So we've got the three leaders we've been talking about. So we've got Luke McLean, we've then got Max Del Orco, and then Stephen Michaels in third. Behind, we've currently got Jorn Jens. He's on his own a little bit at the moment. Javier Soto following, you know, fairly closely behind. And we've got Sam Kumo, Fabio DeMarco, and Jan, or I'm going to struggle with that surname, Nisolowski. We'll go for that for now. So they're all running relatively close together, but just stringing out a little bit. Really, it's just position two and position three that are holding fairly close together with that group.
Just seeing if anyone's actually made it out of the pits from the first incident.
Yeah, I think, unfortunately, from the replay, I think I'd be surprised if anyone gets out. I mean, in this F1 car, it's only the front wing that will get repaired in iRacing. No other damage will get repaired, so it would be brave for somebody to look to carry on with any other damage from there.
It looks like nobody's left the session as of yet, so they will be, fingers crossed, coming back out. So they'll at least get some points. But as we can still see, the second and third are still hammer and tong trying to keep this pace up all the while. McLean is just pulling away.
Yeah, I think, you know, you could wonder whether there's a strategy difference and that's what's making the bigger gap at the minute. Perhaps Luke is conceivably going for a one-stop, but I think it's extremely likely. We're really looking at certainly the leaders taking a no-stop strategy here. So it'd be the same with Stephen. I'd be surprised if maybe he's that much quicker because he's lighter and fewer. I think this is perhaps just a pure pace difference at the moment. Still early on, you know, still a long way for the race for everyone to settle in.
With this only being a no-stop race, as we can see, what will the tyres be like?
Well, I really think the tyres at this circuit aren't looking too bad, so it's really quite a low speed circuit overall. I mean, we have a fast section that the leaders are heading through at the moment, going through the S's in the second half of the circuit, but really the tyres, we're not expecting to have too much drama. I'm sure certainly at the end of this this strength field race, you know, they're going to manage their tyres a little bit perhaps through the middle of a race, but we're not expecting any big dramas. There's, again, Stephen's very, very close going into a hairpin there on Max.
Yeah, he's tucked up right close behind, isn't he? So a quick look, who's setting fastest laps? Looks like that previous lap, it was McLean again, the fastest lap of the race.
And that's even in the SEO one. Max P2, he's gone wide coming up towards turn four there. So Stephen's pressure that he's been putting on the whole time has paid dividends there. So Stephen Michaels up to P2. And it looks like Max Del Orco is currently down to P4. So that moves, was it Sam up an extra position there, I think? No, it's Javi Soto, maybe.
Yeah,
I got myself muddled up. So Jorn Jens is now in P3, Max Del Orco down into P4, and then we have Javier Soto P5, sorry. So yeah, so we were really focusing on that start of year. All that pressure that Stephen Michaels is putting on, it paid off. It got him his position. Now we can see whether he's going to be able to, you know, close that gap to Luke McLean and see whether he's got the pace to match. So we're looking at, what, 3-4 second gap? Maybe a little bit under at the moment between those two. So we'll keep an eye on that over the next few laps.
Just looking about 3 seconds, 3.8. So it does seem to be that McLean is still pulling away from Michaels.
Yeah, and I can imagine as well, it will take maybe a couple of laps for Michaels to find where his pace is now that he's not in the dirtier, and perhaps just bed in a little bit. So maybe after a couple of laps, we might see a true picture as to what the difference could be. So already we're on to lap 7 of this race. I mean, it shuts a short little circuit, 1 minute, 10 laps at, or quicker that we're looking at. So yeah, lap 7 of the 35 race. We're not going to be hanging about getting through this one this week.
Anything happening further down the field?
Well, we've currently got Lou Baboni and Christopher Ellis running in fairly close proximity. I think we're looking at P10 and P11. So they're just coming into the fast S's now, in the second half of the circuit. So that's maybe looking like our closest little battle at the moment. But again, in that dirty air, Louis Bavoni is going to be, you know, struggling to be able to keep into that that dirty air the whole time. You know, as soon as you get, well, depending on setup even as well as circuit, you know, within 1.5 seconds, you know, at least maybe, then really they're going to start getting affected by this dirty air. And unfortunately, again, you know, I said the main overtaking opportunities perhaps at the end of a lap that we've just been through into the hairpin, and yet you've got to have gone through the fastest point of the circuit, the fast S's, very similar to Maggots Beckett's at Silverstone. And if you're in the dirt, yeah, you're going to be struggling to manage to deal with that.
Looks like we've got Max again catching up to Jon Jens.
Yeah, Max trying to recover from his little moment coming into turn four. Very easy done, I have to say. Actually, the race that I completed last night, I went off in exactly that point, going over the crest approaching turn four. And if you just don't quite get the entry right, very, very easy to end up just running out into the gravel. And lucky as well not to end up in a wall, which I didn't see any contact from Max with all.
You actually finished a race, Lee?
Well, as much as a backmarker tried to prevent, I finished a race with lots of damage.
Ah, right.
Yeah,
not
more familiar.
Luck, are we?
Well, less about that maybe at the minute, the better. But in, you know, talk about backmarkers as well. You know, again, as this race goes through, this is a tight circuit for negotiating backmarkers. So, you know, once we start getting a bit closer there, I think we're going to find that you know, it's going to be a bit of work maybe for the leaders, or the backmarkers certainly going to have to pay a lot of attention. As Louis Bavoni here gets very close again, going in towards turn two, so he's really trying to hustle Christopher and look to make up that position and move up to P10.
All the while, Mr. Williams is biding his time, sitting roughly about 1.5 seconds behind.
Contact! All three of them. So very easy done, Christopher. Just losing the rear. It looked like coming out. Absolutely, and collecting all three of them. So I think all three must have some damage of some description. Certainly looks like Louis and Louis Bavoni and Liam Williams there do have damage.
Such a shame, though. Really.
Just looking at the relay now as well coming up. And yeah, it's just, you know, unfortunate, one of those things with running wide out of the exit of turn four there.
And now we have Sukumo. Got about a second gap to Fabio. As we can still see the replay going on there.
Yeah, very easily done, and as I say, especially a tight circle like this, you know, if the car in front of you spins, there's not really a huge amount of choice that you're going to have to be able to negotiate. So yeah, Sam Kimmer there, P6, I think, you know, currently the highest of the Arrow drivers. He'll be content maybe for now, you know, hoping maybe to pick off a place or two further in the race, but I said the race going quick, but it's still a long race, so he just needs to just keep it clean, keep it consistent, keep the concentration up.
I think Sam may actually be the only one left. Alex on the first.
Of course,
from
yeah.
The start.
Alex and then Liam, yeah.
And then Liam just.
But Sam's got, you know, fairly close company from behind with Carmo there. Yeah.
Well, so, seems to be roughly about 1 second gap. But no, things seem to be spreading out a little now.
Yeah, I think, yeah, as expected, unfortunately, we had a lot of action in those first couple of laps, and really, you know, this is not an ideal circuit really for the F1 car. So I think we're looking at, you know, just people trying to keep their concentration, keep it consistent, and not do anything silly. It looks like Luke McLean's really pulled a big gap now on Stephen Michael there. What gap are you showing now on your screen?
I'm seeing around about 4 seconds.
Yeah, so he's got, okay, not as much as I thought. Then he's made what, 0.4 since we last had a look, but
yeah,
it shows him maybe that Stephen hasn't, you know, got that pace to close up the gap now that he's in free air again.
Maybe it just looks bigger than what it is.
My blimp camera view telling me lies slightly.
We've got Yen and Soto in 4th and 5th, there's about a 2 second gap between those two. but not a lot that's happening really. Closest battle on the track at the minute is through with Sam Kumo and Fabio.
And great seeing the live speeds coming through on the stream there as well, with our overlay showing their top ends going into the hairpin there towards the back of the circuit. I think
these guys use KPH rather than MPH.
I think most people in the F1 car do seem to go for for metric. So certainly when I switched to the F1, all the references was changed to metric. That's like a bit of adjusting after being used to the Star Mazda, where I definitely were the Imperial.
Star Mazda, much of a big difference?
Star Mazda for me is just so light and twitchy, so the whole time the rear is moving around, and it's such delicate little inputs on the steering. You're really steering with the rear of the car more than the front. The F1 car feels a lot more to me like it should. It feels like you can grab it by the scruff of the neck a bit more, and the top guys no doubt are sliding around all these corners, and aerobs carry a lot more apex speed than I think is possible, but it's a lot more planted. We know there's obviously all that extra potential in the aerodynamics, and it's a car that you can really grab by the scruff of the neck, whereas I feel the Star Mazda, you just edge it around the corners, and you just encourage it and just nudge it on slightly, and it's a very different style of controlling, but of course the same skills that are going to be used in the fast drivers in both types of cars.
It's quite interesting to know that it's not just the tin tops that you drive like that.
Looks like we might have some back markers starting to come into play a little bit now for the leaders, as we have Luke McLean and sort of to head through the first half of the circuit now.
Apologies for the overlay, it's acting a little weird there then. He's showing everyone as a lap down.
So I think we're still seeing the closest battle on track at the minute being Sam Kumo and Fabio DeCarmo. Still a couple of second gap between it, isn't there? But still keeping them honest.
Looks like Sam's pulled an extra second up in there. So maybe it might start switching between Yen and Soto. Again, a 2 second gap between them.
Great little view from the back of Sam's car there, watching Fabio DeCarmo chasing him through the S's. Nice little shot as they head towards the hairpin at the back of the circuit.
This is my camera flips over to Yen. Yuri Yen, sorry. And now to Javi Soto, who's actually in 5th position at the minute.
Yeah, he'll be happy with this. So Javier Soto's been around for a while, I think. He's a top driver, I think, as far as I know, mainly from the Star Mazdas, and I think possibly this is his first series in really committing to the F1 car out. So he's got good pace already, and no doubt he's just going to get stronger and stronger as the season progresses. So 5th place behind a couple of DWC drivers as well. I'm sure he'll be very happy with that to start him off for week 1.
It looks like Michaels has set the fastest lap of the race with a 108.921.
Yeah, so it really does give us a hint then that they are really got to be looking at a no-stop race. I mean, we're in the mid part of the race now, and they're running, 1.7 seconds off the pole position, so no doubt at all those leaders we really think the whole field are going to be going for a no-stop race. They're just struggling carrying all that extra fuel around at the moment. The main reason, I think, for the no-stop here is the slowish circuit, as we said, so the average speeds here are quite slow, but it's really a very long pit lane coming in. It's just you lose far, far too much time travelling into and out of your pit stall again.
Yeah. We've got McLean on screen at the minute, who's still 4 seconds in front of Michaels. And seems to be keeping up a very consistent pace.
Yeah, it's really what you expect from these top level drivers, I think. It's, as I say, again, tricky circuit. You know, all the crests, all the hills, it can really cause that very easy loss of time just with a lapse of concentration. But yeah, nailing him in every lap after lap.
Interesting, McLean's last lap was his quickest one of the race so far, with a 108.938.
Right, I was going to talk through a lap with Sam as we see him crossing over the start-finish line. So we're coming through turn one into turn two, down into first gear, heavy on the brakes, and just coming over the crest. You've got to be so careful getting on the power onto the crest there. Same here, down into third from fourth, over the crest, ever so light on the throttle, being careful. Down into that turn four where we saw the three cars getting all caught up, and it's just trying to get as hard on the power as early as you can to carry as much momentum as you can through this carousel now. Stay tight to the inside as you go around, hard on the power now. There's a bit of a bump there at the bottom, so you do have to just get that line right. Heading down into the hairpin at the back of the circuit now, braking probably at the red billboard that we saw flash by, and just treating it really as a single corner all the way around. Flat now, all the way down the back of the circuit, so these S's should just be flat, fifth, sixth gear. Little clip of the curb on the inside, really see how the car gets unsettled clipping these curbs. Seventh gear now, flat still, maybe a little bit of a lift, it sounded like, with the fuel. And then hard on the brakes down into the hairpin, all the way down to first gear. Stay as tight as you can. A lot of drivers you'll see really cutting that inside corner as you come through, flat through the last corner. And here's a start-finish line again. I mean, it shows how short of a lap that is. 1 minute, 10 we're looking at that lap. And it just really flies by. These inside curbs that we saw here, Sam just clip on those S's at the back of the circuit. Every single inside curb pretty much on this track, you need to be very, very careful. If you just catch it a fraction too much, and you're really getting spat out to the far side of the circuit again.
As we jump back up to McLean, he's now 5 seconds in front of Michaels. So he is showing some pace here later on in this race. Sam on the other hand, it looks like he'd lost a second there to Fabio. As the camera flicks to a back marker just getting past. But no, it seems the only race that's on the circuit at the minute is between Sam and Fabio.
Yeah, they're really quite close to the match at the moment.
Just ahead of them with Soto and Yen.
Yeah, so a quick run through the top 10 again, just to make sure we know where we are. Pretty much as was, really, isn't it? So Luke McLean, P1, Stephen Michaels, P2, Max DeLorco, P3, Yon Yens, P4, Javier Soto, P5, Sam Kuno, P6, Fabio DiMarco, P7, Jan, oh no, it's that surname again, Jan Nislowski, I'm really sorry for that, Paolo Accurso, P9, Christopher Ellis, P10. In fact, Christopher Ellis looks like he's still going in after the contact. He's the last of the runners at the moment. Everyone else below that from P11, P18, they've had damage, and either maybe in the pits waiting for repairs and seeing what happens, but more likely we're not going to see them back out on circuit again.
Again, apologies for the little bug on the overlay, which we've just seen right now, showing us the guys are lapped down, even though they're not.
Yeah, I think it's just where it just needs to wait for them to cross the start-finish line. As they cross the start-finish line, it updates to the correct mark, I think.
They're on lap 20 of 36. How would the guys be feeling right now?
Well, this is the sort of time maybe where that concentration could just start to cause a little bit of a problem. Again, you wouldn't expect it of maybe the top four, top five drivers. They're so much at the top of their game, and really, lapses of concentration in a relatively short race like this shouldn't be happening. But it's going to be so easily done, and especially maybe with for a fair few of them, they're all running on their own a little bit. Maybe just a little bit of monotony sort of thing just coming in, and they may just start to have to keep an eye on that concentration level as they're going. Easy, easy, lose a half a second, 2 seconds, just in, you know, a single corner.
Just looking, it looks like Christopher Ellis has pitted lap 17.
Yeah, and I think Javier Soto's pitted as well. It looks like we're down to P8 for Soto now. So, hey, it shows it's going to surprise me, maybe. You know, really, we've heard and we were, you know, we've seen that no stop looks like the fastest way around. So, unless, you know, there's some differences in setup, that really means, you know, some people weren't able to keep the tyres alive. Well, it's just people have maybe not quite done their homework and just assumed, based on all the previous series, that it's got to be a one-stop race, and that's what we're doing. So really, we could have a bit of a couple of problems here for those people that have done one stop.
Just on board now with really gonna regret saying this. Leclowski.
Yeah, good. I think you really ruined that just as much as I did. So, yeah, it's all good. At least we keep each other company for that.
Yeah.
Good ARL TV tradition.
We always seem to find the most peculiar names, don't we?
Yeah, so just having a quick look through then. So, yeah, Luke McLean's definitely still out in P1. Stephen Michaels out in P2. Max Dorlorco, P3. So he's moved up a position then, right? Because Jorn Jens was ahead of him when Max had his little problem earlier on. So Jorn Jens is behind at the moment, P4. Sam Kumo, P5. Fabio DeMarco still keeping him company. And then, yeah, really then, perhaps is it only Saito in the top sort of, what, 7-8 cars who has made his stop so far?
Yes. With Ellis in 10th, who's shown us 2 laps down.
Yeah, perhaps that was for damage then, so perhaps that's why he pitted heels for the car that that collected Liam and whoever else it was off the top of my head coming out of turn 4 there.
So we have Soto here.
Yeah, really, we should be expecting then Soto to really be quickly closing this gap up to now that he's made a stop. So he's got fresh tyres, you know, he was on a lighter fuel in the first place as well. I guess they're obviously on the same amount of fuel now to make it to the end of the race, but really we should be expecting Soto to make quite quick work of getting right close to the back of him. It's just seeing then how he can cope with that dirty area as he gets a bit closer still.
Yeah, he's about 1.2 seconds behind, so again the closest battle on the circuit is this one that you can see.
And he's already there in the dirty air then in that 1.2 seconds. So it's just, you know, again, perhaps setup differences. How well has he done in allowing for running in dirty air to allow him to get closer to Jan in front? So you're saying about my belief that this is the first season that Soto's running properly, and so. Yeah, you'd think he's obviously done a lot of prep for this race. So I'm surprised to see him have made that one stop with essentially nobody else around having done the same.
Especially with the team that he's in as well, wouldn't they be?
Yeah, absolutely. On the flip side, maybe they know something that we don't, and maybe he's going to come storming through in the second half. But it does seem a little bit strange for now. What sort of lap times has he been running, Dean, compared to sort of those around him? Does it show that he's on the one stop?
Soto, his last lap round was a 109.8. So he is still on pace, but Jan in front of him again matched him with a 109.8.2. So still maintaining that gap in front. Now again, has just crossed over the line, he's still in the 109s.
Yeah, so strong pace from these guys. So, you know, it's. It's depressing when I think back to what my qualifying time is, and these guys are running with fuel in a race that's fairly happily in those mid to high 109s, it looks like. So Soto's getting closer now to Jan. He's as close as he's been so far, so it'd be interesting to see if he can get a good exit out of a hairpin coming up and get a good run down through the S's, and then really the final hairpin coming out the back of the circuit. That's going to be his only real possibility without an error from Jan to be able to get by. But it's not looking like he's going to be able to get close enough. He's dropping back slightly through the S's, which is expected again in that dirty air.
Luke McLean set his fastest lap of the race on lap 22 with a 108.6. So he's just getting quicker and quicker as this race goes on.
Yeah, absolutely. Jan really cutting the corner across there into the hairpin, really getting all the way across the yellow line.
He's now south of his point 0.7. I think I said that right. Or is he just 0.7? Ah, sorry, yes. Just 0.7 behind him now, so. It's catching every lap.
Yeah, this is really looks like where our potential is going to be for a little bit of action. So, interesting to see if Jan's going to need to get defensive at some point, if he feels the need to just protect that line going into the hairpins, maybe. Not on this lap, not yet, but you know, maybe give it a couple more and Soto gets used to running that dirty air and can close up a little bit more, perhaps.
These guys that we're watching are 41 seconds behind the leader.
So really, with another 10 laps to go, you know, the leaders aren't going to be far behind them. You know, they're not going to be a million miles away from lapping them. So we're looking at a 70-second lap, and they're 40 seconds behind. So, oh, yeah, and sideways into the hairpin there on the entry. Beautifully judged, just locking up the rear slightly and power sliding in all the way through. Didn't look like it lost them any time. It's if you can carry the momentum, actually staying as tight as you can to the inside there, it can work out okay.
McLean, she's putting a lap on. Who was that he was putting a lap on? Who's in ninth?
I think that's Paolo, is it? Paolo Accurso?
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah, I think he's. Perhaps he's had damage elsewhere in the race. I think I saw him taking it very steady earlier on and letting a couple of cars go by, so perhaps he's just trying to ensure he gets to the end of the race and just picks up a bit of SR and a bit of I rating.
What's about the average I rating in this race?
Well, really, I mean, we've got these DWC drivers in here as well at the very top level of the I rating, so I'll be surprised if we're not looking at, well, what, strength of field of, you know, way above 3,000, isn't it? The average. So Liam Williams just scraped in the very bottom, I seem to remember. Yeah, he was ranked number 17 of the 18, and he's, oh, what's his I rating?
I'm just going to pull him up.
Yeah, so it's got to be way up, my guessing. We've got to be in the 4,000s, really, you'd think, of that I rating.
Liam Williams is 3,358.
Yeah, so for him to just barely scrape into the bottom of his strength of field, it's a strong, strong grid that we've got here today. Positive, hopefully, for the rest of the season, and especially at a track that, you know, a lot of people were disappointed by maybe when they saw the schedule released at the beginning of the season.
Looks like Soto has had a little spin, actually. Not pitted, had a little spin.
Ah, so maybe that will make a lot more sense, and then that explains also why maybe he's not gained as much as we thought on Jan Izimaitov. So there we go, we're back to our original plan of nobody daring to go for a one-stop.
As we have Stephen coming round to lap Pablo. Pablo was very kind in ducking out the way in the last minute.
Yeah, so you see, he's looking close coming out of the hairpin there, so it's just so difficult to get back on the power again and keep a run on that car in front when that car can always get on that power those 5-10 metres before you, no matter how hard you try.
Gap is still within a second.
Yeah, and we've already seen earlier in the race, of course, how that pressure can really create that opportunity. So we saw Stephen Michaels doing a great job of hustling Max at the beginning of the race, and it really does have that effect. You know, even with these top level drivers, it's going to take something away from your concentration, and just you feel the need to go defensive once in a while and just not quite take the same lines as normal maybe. And if Soto can keep hustling Jan here, then he could well, you know, get a reward from it.
Another great on board you there. You just jump up to look to the rear wing.
Yeah, we're going to see how much Soto closes under the brakes into the hairpin there, just to shoots right up to the back of him, though maybe not as close as he has been in previous laps. Just drop back slightly now.
Just again, Michaels. Luke McLean, sorry. Lap 28. 108.4.
Yeah, gradually burning that fuel lower and lower. I'm surprised it's 1.2 seconds off his pole position time. And so they haven't got much fuel on board anymore, six laps of fuel. So maybe it just goes to show that those tyres are on sort of the edge of being able to do this no-stop. And they're just bringing it home now.
As he does again, last lap, 108.3.
Oh, there we go. So, yeah, gradually creeping closer and closer.
He just seems to be in a class of his own at the minute. Now 6.9 seconds ahead of Michaels.
Yeah, he's just got to be cruising around now. And I'm sure Michaels is as well. I can't imagine that Michaels is really trying to hustle and make an effort to close that gap. He just wants to maintain that second position, I'm sure.
Michaels has a 8-second gap. Back to Max. He's just coming up to put a lap on Pablo.
Yeah, and again, he takes his normal route, so taking that nice wide line around the outside of the hairpin. Not a bad idea. Allow the car on the inside. Certainly back, it's better than staying on the inside and locking the front, as a backmarker did to me yesterday.
Jan, as he's coming down that downhill right-hander, he just looks like he's washing out wide. Wondering if his front left is starting to go off.
And it's very, very easy just to carry a little bit too much momentum of the into the entry, and same into the hairpin there. He slides into the entry of the hairpin, so it's, you can see the pressure that Soto's putting him under. So he's just, maybe just needs to go back to basics a little bit, slow in, fast out, and just keep, make sure he gets a drive out those corners that doesn't allow Soto to get a run in him.
We have six laps remaining.
This race has really gone by really quite quickly, even with perhaps a relatively lack of action from, well, once we got through the first couple of laps anyway.
We have Sam Kumo up to fifth, who's the sole remaining AR UK driver. So he's kept his nose out of it all, and he's going, but has a 1.7 gap.
And Soto's really closed up the gap now going into turn four. He's as close as he's been for a good few laps on the back of Jan. We'll see how this develops as we go through the second half of this lap, heading through the carousel now. Here we are on the screen.
Just seems to get that better drive out of this carousel though, doesn't he?
Yeah, that's all you need. Again, just that slow in, fast out approach slightly and just maintain the gap. But Soto's looking closer. Again, it's going to be really tough to try and consider an overtake into a hairpin. He's not going to want to take a huge risk. He just want to be sure of an opportunity before he takes it. Yeah, and then just losing the time slightly through his S's as expected. It's going to be so hard to carry the same momentum as a car in front when you're running through all of that dirty air through the fastest section of the circuit. What we really need there is a slow corner leading onto that long straight for the last hairpin there. So yeah, again, Jan just getting a little bit light over the crest coming through turn two. They're very, very easily done as he heads over the same heading into turn four. It's just being ever so careful on the throttle, just balancing the throttle there as you go over the crests.
McLean now 8 seconds in front of Michaels.
Just in a class of his own at the moment. So be interesting to see if Luke really decides to run a fairly solid run of events for this season, or if he's just going to do an outing here and there. I guess trying to think when the DWC season actually starts. I guess it's going to overlap with season one at some point, so I can't imagine the DWC drivers continuing through this Grand Prix series all the way through the season.
We only have 9 drivers left on the track at the minute as well.
Yeah, I think Paolo is the last of runners lap down at the moment. So again, just to quickly run through that top 9 then. Yeah, we're looking as we have been before. So Luke McLean is still P1. As I say, 8-9 seconds in the lead. Stephen Michaels, P2. Max DeLorco, P3 still. So that's still our podium, really, as it was at the very start of the race. Just the order shuffled slightly. P4, Jan still. P5, Sam Kumo. P6, Fabio De Carmo. P7, Jan Nislowski, who we're watching on screen at the moment. And P8, Javier Soto. And then, as we say, P9, Paolo Accurso, just running a lap down still at the moment, just trying to keep his nose clean.
Just two laps remaining, so.
Yeah, and again, short laps, so this is going to be done. So really, I imagine that Soto is just happy to hang back a little bit now. I think into the last section of the race, he's not been able to really close that gap enough on Jan, so he's not going to go for a do-or-die effort on the last lap, I wouldn't think. But we'll keep a close eye out. All it's going to take, again, is a mistake from Jan, struggling on his tyres maybe, and Soto could have a run.
Again, nothing much else happening on the track. Maybe the only other little battle is with Mr. Kumo. That gap is now down to 0.9. Whereas the one that we're looking at the minute is 0.6. So, two little battles happening with just two laps remaining. Just check if Stephen Michaels has set himself a new PB.
It's another lap, so surely he has.
It says a 108.2, so I think he's actually gone the quickest guy in the circuit. So he's still showing that he has got the pace. Maybe it's just a little too late.
Yeah. It's a good marker to be putting down for their DWC campaign as well. A couple of strong showings in this and show everyone what pace you've got. And it's just going to put you in a good frame of mind, maybe, for the start of that DWC season. Soto gets Slary out of the hairpin there, spinning up their ears.
Luke McLean on his final lap. Coming through the S's.
Well, really, from start to finish for Luke McLean, it's been very, very straightforward as he comes out of the hairpin here. So, great race. You know, essentially, you know, faultless from what we've seen. You know, he got away, scampered away quickly at the start. And great job there for Luke McLean winning the strength of field for week one at Sonoma Raceway. P2, we did have Stephen Michaels. P3, we've got Max DeLorco just coming over the line now. And then we've got the lap down, Paolo Accurso just coming into the final hairpin. And we're still just watching Soto getting closer and closer to Jan now. I'm just jumping back to him now. So he's as close as he's been through the S's, but again, it's going to be tough to make a maneuver into the final hairpin. So just watching him now coming through the final S's. Soto's as close as he's been all race coming into that hairpin, but surely he's going to be too far back to make a move. Jan goes defensive. He feels the need to round the outside. Can Soto cut back? Is he going to try and push right around the outside? Oh, they're almost side by side coming through. But Jan's going to hold on. What a great little finish to the race. A little bit of action just at the very end there.
Good racing, those guys.
That was good. Nice and clean as well. Nothing crazy as we wanted. But yeah, Jan really felt the need to go defensive at the end there into that final hairpin. Okay, well, you know, as expected, you know, not a huge amount of overtaken, unfortunately, through the race, but you know, it was what was going to be with the track. So, just to run through our final results then, you know, as it's been really, Luke McLean, P1, comfortable win it seems. So, pole position, overall pole position for the week as well, and a comfortable win to start him off. Stephen Michaels, P2, again, once he managed to hustle Max into that mistake early on, he was pretty much left to it for the rest of the race. Max DeLorco did get that P3, so that was the podium. Jorni Enns with Sam Kumo, P4, P5, fairly close company towards the end of the race there. Fabio De Carmo, P6. Jan Nislowski, you're going to have to let us know how much we're butchering your name. I do apologise, Jan. P7 with Javier Soto just finishing, what are we at, a tenth and a half behind as we cross the line. So that was as close as it could be coming out of the end there. And then, as we said, we had Paolo Accurso a lap down, P9. All the rest of the runners did not finish.
Just looking in the chat there, and I see that Stephen Michaels actually ran out of fuel just before the end, so...
Perfectly judged then.
Doesn't come much closer than that. If this was a real F1, I'm sure I'd get a slap for us from not enough fuel.
That's it, not enough for a sample.
Random samples. Now, I will remind everybody that we are on TeamSpeak and you can jump on for some interviews if you like. Let's shout it if anyone's watching and wants to come on.
Yeah, absolutely. It'd be good to find out what we missed, any corrections that we made of that we need making as we go through. At least we got that correction of Soto not having actually made his pit stop. Just like to thank the sponsors then that we had for the race. Is going to see them now as they come up.
I think he's busy playing with a replay.
So there we go. So yeah, so GT Omega Racing. So thank you very much for a sponsor. Without their help, we're going to really struggle to be able to put on our broadcast here, as well as providing prizes for our other series that we run as well. Sim News Daily. Go and have a look at the website. Any useful news that's going to be happening in sim racing, you're going to be able to find there quite easily. And of course ARL itself, who well, essentially, that's going to be us, isn't it? That's who is putting on the broadcast. And again, all the backbone that has behind. Thanks very much to Darren in the cameras today. You can have a look at us on Twitter, Facebook, Apex Racing TV for Twitter, ARL TV for Facebook. Get in touch. So just having a look at the replay of the start as well, I think, in a moment. Have a couple of looks of those again. See the carnage that we saw on the first lap. You said it was best. Troy Dean.
Yeah, it was Troy Schultz from the start, but I think it might be best looking a little bit further back to see exactly what the carnage was like.
Yeah, oh. So it looked like the car on the left of Troy as well got a little bit sideways, but yeah, ultimately it was Troy there that had the hard luck of spearing across the left there.
Yeah, which was actually Alex Simpson.
Let's not hope that's not a sign of Alex's luck to come for the rest of the season here.
So we are still sat here waiting for people to come, but like nobody wants to turn up.
Yeah, I think we'll hang on for a few minutes, say give people a chance to come across if they want. I think hopefully once we get a couple of races in and people get used to us doing these broadcasts, I'm sure we'll see them pop in nice and quick.
As we have Sam Kumar, who's just jumped up.
Oh, perfect.
So I will grab him up. Hey, Sam.
Evening, hey. Sam.
Thanks for having me. Hey.
How did your race go, Sam? Sorry.
What?
How was the race for you, Sam?
It was pretty solid, I think, considering I managed to avoid the carnage on the start.
Yeah, you just about managed to scrape through that then, Sam, right? So we're pretty clear and free after the first lap?
Yeah, I had a good race with Fabio, who was behind me. I just needed to keep the pace and not let him get any chances to overtake.
Yeah, I think we were seeing the dirty air, obviously, as normal in these cars, was really causing a problem for a couple of battles for anyone to close. What sort of gap did you feel that Fabio was stuck back to with the dirty air?
It really changed, but I don't think he managed to get closer than 1 second.
Yeah, so especially on a circuit like this, where you've got those fast corners leading into the hairpins, it's really going to be tough for anyone to make a move.
Through the SS you can be around 1 second behind without really feeling it, but through the fast sweeping right-hander, even 1 second and you have to lift off big time.
What did you think of the pace of the top two today, Sam? I mean, Luke McLean, Stephen Michaels, they really looked to be in a race of their own today, disappearing away.
Yeah, well, Max Delorco managed to at least hit same kind of lap times. But, I mean, Luke and Stephen, they are WDC championship drivers.
Yeah, so we had a good start to the season then. So week one, P5 for Sam. You're going to be obviously doing the next race as well, I presume, Sam, at 8 o'clock. See if you can get a bit better result there.
Yeah, I don't know. I got to wake up early tomorrow, so I think I'll pass on that. And I managed to get good points already.
Okay, good result last night. All right, well done.
Thanks.
We will see you back in on throughout the season, I'm sure, and. Good luck as you carry on through. Who do you miss you here and now?
Yeah, thanks.
No problem. As we have Stephen Michaels just joining, ready for interview. If you want to pull him up.
Yeah, you'll need to do that, I'm afraid, Dean. I haven't got the ability.
Welcome, Stephen.
Hello, hello, Stephen.
Hey there, guys.
Hi. So, how was your race today then, Stephen? P2, 8 seconds behind Luke McLean?
I could say it was pretty decent enough to keep up with Team Redline driver and pressuring Orion team driver that switched over to Hygera.
Yeah, you did. You were very close to Mac at the beginning, right? So, yeah, pressuring him into a mistake to gain that second position.
Yeah, I only pressured him to get basically the second position and get close to him as possible as I can to take second until he either made a mistake or just gave up the position.
And then, did you feel you had the pace on Luke if you hadn't been stuck behind Max initially at the start of the race? It looked like the lap times were very close between the two of you today.
I would feel like I would have the pace to keep up with Luke, but it's only from practicing a lot every day and getting the qualifying set and the race set all set to go for just this race and some other races that will probably be going on. And yeah, basically that's it.
So how are you using the Grand Prix Series, Stephen, as a prep for the DWC season?
I'm just basically just going to all the tracks as much as I can before the DWC race at Circuit de Spa for 44 laps, and just to, you know, prepare myself and give myself a fresh start and everything for the DWC.
When is it that the DWC starts? Sorry, season. It's during season one, isn't it?
It starts after Zandvoort, I believe, on March 2nd.
Yeah, so that's going to come around very quick then, right?
It sure will.
Do you have any plans to run any more before then?
Any plans to, like, run the A-class races?
Yeah.
I plan to run the A-class races until Zandvoort. You know, to just keep going to that and just prepare for Circuit de Spa for the 2-week plan, as us DWC drivers get like 2 weeks to get everything prepared and all set for the race.
And will you be recommending the Sonoma Raceway as a possible circuit in future on the DWC schedule?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Well, thanks very much for joining us, Stephen. Good luck in your next few races that we're going to see you about before the DWC season starts. Great result for your first race that we've seen you in.
Thanks, guys.
You're more than welcome. Well, that looks like everybody that we've got for interviews there. I think I wondered if we might have seen Alex or maybe Liam, but I guess perhaps they don't want to join us right now, which is not surprising. So, I think that's going to be wrapping up ARL TV's broadcast of Week 1 from Sonoma Raceway for the iRacing Grand Prix Series. How did you find that, Dean, covering your first F1 race?
First F1 race went really well, actually. Second ever broadcast, so...
Yeah, I don't think we had too many howlers as we went through, did we? I think we got through all right for our first shot, so no doubt, as we get more familiar with the drivers and the liveries and how it all works, it's only going to get better and better as we go through.
Yes, obviously. And I'm sure we'll be looking in the forums for some critiques and some kind words, I'm sure.
Absolutely, I'm looking forward to it. Right, well, so I've been Lee Thompson. Thank you again to Dean Prescott for keeping me company in the commentary booth, and thank you also to Darren for working the cameras in the background. This has been ARL TV, and we shall see you live Sunday night next week, 8 o'clock. And it's going to be at Silverstone, isn't it? So good
six
turnout
o'clock.
Expected. 6 o'clock, sorry. Yeah, get ahead of myself. 8 o'clock is going to be my race. Six o'clock
is going to be my race as well.
So Silverstone next week. Hopefully a good turnout. And hopefully potential for more overtaking as we go through. Okay, thanks a lot, guys. We shall see you next week.